be moderating the panel from now on. So the floor is yours.
Okay, great. Hope everyone can hear me. Just give a wave if you can't for any reason. Thank you so much for having me here today. My name is Rana Foroohar. I'm the associate editor and global business columnist at Financial Times. I've been following global supply chains for really my entire 30 years as a journalist. My first book, Makers and Takers, got into a lot of the trade-offs between efficiency and resiliency that have been a part of business for some time now. So very excited to do this panel. I'll just make a couple of observations and I'd like to quickly introduce our panelists. And we've got, we've got about 45 minutes for our panel. And I also just want to remind listeners that they can actually take part and submit questions, sending them to info@Open Markets Institute or using Twitter hashtag resilient systems. And those will appear for me later on a screen and we can call them out. So just a couple of things, even before COVID, the problem of efficiency versus resilience has been with us. You know, I think back to a tragedy like the Rana Plaza factory collapse in Bangladesh, for example, which was the result of complex supply chains, looked great on paper in a headquarters that a CFO was looking at, but there was a lot of risk in that system that came at a huge human cost. I've also been amazed in the last few weeks at how quickly systems can become more resilient if there's good leadership. I mean, I look at all kinds of interesting solutions coming from the business community in the US and elsewhere, people retooling supply chains within a matter of 48 hours when the proper leadership is in place. So I think that there's a lot of challenge, but there's a lot of opportunity here. So let me move forward and quickly introduce our panel, and then I'm gonna give them an opportunity to speak for a few minutes, and then we're going to have a discussion between ourselves. Great panel here. We've got Michael Osterholm, who's the director of the Center for Infectious Disease Research and Policy at the University of Minnesota and author of The Deadliest Enemy, Our War Against Killer Germs. We also have Yossi Sheffi, the director of the MIT Center for Transportation and Logistics and the author of The Power of Resilience. Sharan Burrow, who is the General Secretary of the International Trade Union Conference and a great buddy of mine. Christopher Gopal, the former VP of Worldwide Operations at Dell Computer and a member of the Defense Business Board and author of Supercharging Supply Chains. So you guys are the all-star team of resiliency. Michael, I think I'm going to start with you because as part of my prep for this event, I was reading your incredibly prescient piece, 2005 piece in Foreign Affairs called Preparing for the Next Pandemic. And I just want to read a few lines here. It says, given the extent to which modern commerce relies on the precise and readily available international trade of goods and services, a shutdown of the global economic system would dramatically harm the world's ability to meet surging demand for essential commodities such as foods and medicines during a crisis. All right, so you were sounding the alarm on this over a decade ago. What happened? Why are we in the situation we are in right now? Yossi, I'm gonna call on you because I know that you're the most tech savvy person among us. And being from MIT, you're gonna pick up. I know you have some slides that you'd like to show which could set the stage on why our production systems failed, why we're at this moment. So maybe do you wanna run those and then we'll come back to Michael? Oops, we can't hear you. So if you could just unmute.
I was just testing you to see if you know what to tell me.
Good.
I'll put it in the middle of my presentation because what I want to talk about, I wrote several books and wrote a lot of papers on supply chain resilience. So I'm now, you know, talking to a lot of media, and there are certain questions that show a misunderstanding of what's going on. So let me just touch on one issue. So first of all, the difference between just in time and concentration. These are not the same thing. Many pundits complain that modern supply chain management have failed. These systems are based on tight connection between manufacturers, customers, and suppliers, just-in-time supply and manufacturing, and very little safety stock. It is mainly the lack of such inventory that is lamented, saying that corporations choose quote-unquote greed efficiency over the welfare of their customers. This is nonsense. By the way, that's a term, that technical term used at MIT. So it's the Toyota manufacturing system, which was basically adopted by all manufacturers around the world, does not only reduce costs. It resulted in huge gain in product quality, in the ability to respond quickly to market changes, in reduction in waste, in ease of repairs, and of course, low cost. So let's distinguish between it. I believe that JIT and the connected system should and will continue to be norm in manufacturing. But let's distinguish between this and concentration. And for this, let me share with you a slide. Now, can you see this?
Yeah, we can.
Okay, so this is what's called a bill of material. You see on the top, OEM, original equipment manufacturer. This is the brand company. Let's say in automotive, it would be Ford, GM, Toyota. Then you see tier one supplier, tier two supplier, tier three supplier, all the suppliers under them. And the problem is, if we look at an OEM, the OEM may know who their tier one suppliers are because they pay them. So they know who they are. They have a vague idea of who the tier two suppliers are because tier one doesn't tell them who the tier two suppliers are for a variety of reasons. And they really have no clue deeper in the supply chain. And just let me tell you that some supply chains are 10 and 12 tiers down. So the first problem in supply chain is opaqueness. You don't know who is down there that can hurt you. The second problem, if you look at sometimes the whole industry is vulnerable. Companies are very good at making sure that they themselves are not vulnerable. In general, I'm not talking now about medical supply. We can talk about it later. But companies are making sure that they are not vulnerable. But sometimes, instead of this type of structure, unbeknown to all the OEMs that are depending on one supplier, we call it a diamond structure instead of the tree structure that we showed before. Just to give you an example, a company called Copan, Italian company, it's in Northern Italy. They make swabs, which we are so much needed today. They have 50% of the US market. And of course, they're in Northern Italy. They were closed for a significant amount of time. So anyway, let me stop the sharing and we can talk a lot more about this and a lot of other issues that that we raised before, but let me yield the floor and go on. We can come back to many of these.
Let me actually, I want to, before we move on, because we have a little bit of time, I want to ask you one follow-up question. If you can kind of go a bit deeper on the difference and the importance of connecting systems and yet not having concentration. I think that's a really important point. I mean, there is a debate out there right now, which a couple of other people have flagged, but it's all or nothing. You either have, complete globalization as we've known it since the 1990s, or we're somehow going to this Hobbesian, all against all world in which it's going to be national competition. Can you sketch out what you see as the balance between resiliency and efficiency, keeping what's best of globalization, but also allowing for less concentration?
And I will talk now not about medical supplies, which is really a special case, and can talk about it separately, how medical supplies should be handled. But let me just make a point about resilience of supply chain. In the United States, food is coming to stores. You may not find your specific cereal or specific this or that, but there's no question that food is coming to supermarkets and food is coming to people. In the face of unbelievable change to the demand, to the structure of demand, to the location of demand, supply chain are responding. It's actually amazing. And by the way, let me just make a point about the media, since I'm talking to you. We see a lot of pictures of empty supermarket shelves. These are nonsense. They're taken at the end of the day. You come in the morning and the same supermarket shelves are full. But of course, it makes much better copy to have all these empty empty shelves. With today's information technology, it is not a question of keeping in touch with many suppliers. I'm working with companies like Flex, used to be called Flextronics. They have 18,000 first-year suppliers, an untold number of second and third and fourth-year suppliers. They know about all of them. You realize that Starbucks have 122,000 growers of coffee. On each one of them, they know the name, the family, what they put into the ground. With today's information technology, it's not a question of keeping in touch with, you know, multiple suppliers, multiple customers. Concentration is something else. Concentration sometimes hurts. But also, let me tell you that just a comment about this, because Paul, who I admire, mentioned something. Many companies, not only Netflix, are doing exactly the same thing. Intel goes into every quarter, they'll go into a plant and tell the plant, every quarter, to any one of the plant, and tell the plant manager, you know, this and that supplier are out of business, what do you do? And 20% of the bonus depends on how well they respond. So there are companies who are serious about it. It's easier for Netflix in some sense because it's not physical, but even companies that deal with physical product say, how do you get contract for new transportation? How do you find a new supplier? How quickly you can do quality checks? How quickly you can do engineering? All of these things, people are measured on this. So there are companies who are actually very good at this and take it seriously. I don't want to take too much time. We can come later to medical supply, which are a special case.
Okay, we'll come back to you. One housekeeping thing, I also want to just let everyone know that external participants can also send questions to naec@oecd.org, and we will be able to see those and answer them as well. I see Christopher and Sharan on, so I'm going to come to you all next. Christopher, let me come to you. I'm fascinated. You've basically organized the worldwide supply chains of Dell, which are kind of world famous. I'm sure there must be a Harvard Business School case study on you guys. You know all about engineering efficiency. You also know about the pressures that global corporations are under in terms of how they run their supply chains, the balance between cost, efficiency, labor standards, trade. Talk to us a little bit about where we've come, where the vulnerabilities are in the system, and where you think we're going. And if you can unmute yourself, that would be great.
I talk better when mute, but thank you. I guess I'll be talking from the view of somebody who's been in the trenches. I've been in supply chain management all my life in different industries. And it was evident to us in the field 10, 15, 20 years ago that we were focusing on efficiency sans risk, and that essentially we were constructing an extremely good supply chain system, extremely efficient, extremely effective, and built to break. Dr. Sheffi pointed out the differences with just in time and concentration. That's all correct. The issue really is the concentration of the end supplier. No effective supply chain can function if supply is cut off. And our executives, who are all extremely good, look at the world through the point of view of shareholder value, cost, liquidity. These are critical. Liquidity is the amount of payables and inventory in the supply chain. Cost is the lowest cost per unit, total cost, where they can source it from. And shareholder value really hinges a lot of it on free cash flow and the return on net assets, which is why an excellent supply chain often is a hollow supply chain. And if the supplier breaks for any reason, a COVID pandemic, national aggression, government policy, a tsunami, the supply chain is at risk. And I think that's the trade-off that we have to come and see in terms of financial engineering of the balance sheet versus engineering of the supply chain for maximum national and consumer effectiveness. I recall reading this in somebody's book, it's probably yours, Rana, about makers and takers. And I think that's so appropriate in this regard.
So let me ask you a follow-up question just on that point. I mean, we're dealing with very complex systems and a complex set of variables. I mean, just within the incentive structures of the financial system, we're talking about 20 to 40 years of small tweaks in various areas, from tax to corporate governance to any number of other areas that touch the supply chain, that make it very difficult for a publicly traded company to make different decisions. Do you see, is this a tipping point moment? I mean, do you see the system changing? I know different companies are individually taking stock of resiliency versus efficiency, but how do we recraft the system to incentivize that? Do you have thoughts on that?
Yes, I think someone earlier talked about opportunism, a great term which I've not come across. It's an economist term. And individual executives and individual companies will always do what's best for the company and for themselves. Today, companies don't compete, supply chains compete. And more than that, industries compete. And I think unless executives are given guidelines, and in certain industries, mandates about risk, distributed operations, multiple sources, recovery, we're not going to get it. And I do feel we're at a tipping point. I just read somewhere, for instance, that nearly 97% of our antibiotics come from China. That's ridiculous. We've found Chinese components that actually don't work too well in some of our defense equipment. The previous administrations gave a waiver for some of that. Some of these statistics are terrifying. And so I think we are at a tipping point. I think we've got the people in power who recognize and look at it from a national security perspective. So I do have some optimism.
Okay. I'm going to ask, I see Michael is on now, but Sharan, you've been waiting. So I'm going to ask Sharan to come in and weigh in. Sharan, you have been in the trenches leading labor globally for decades now. You've seen where all the bodies are buried. You've seen some of the human costs of the way business has been done for the last 30 or 40 years. How do you, I mean, maybe you can just give your broad perspective. Why are we at the point we're at? What is changing? Where do you see the energy in this conversation going? Okay, you can unmute yourself and then we'll be able to hear you.
Okay, so great to see you, Rana, even if in captivity. And Rana's my favorite American journalist. I hope that doesn't insult anyone. But
you have my favorite background, by the way. I love your humming.
Yeah, well, I got sick of my office. She tells it like it is. And I thought the last two speakers, both Yossi and Christopher, said it all, really. That's why we have a failed economic model. We have a global labor market that has been simply, that governments have simply failed to regulate. So speaking from a worker's point of view, the vulnerabilities that Yossi and Christopher outlined are actually only able, supply chains are only able to compete because of the labor arbitrage, because of the terrible dehumanizing exploitation of the supply chain model. And the obscurity that Yossi set out simply allows CEOs and companies to hide. There's no reason for it, even before blockchain, but certainly with blockchain now, you can very easily secure contracts and so on. And other companies have done it, as you said. But the fragility of this model has been absolutely exposed when yesterday the global layers, the Global Employers Federation, IOE, the ILO and ourselves were forced to put out a statement that showed how vulnerable our multinational enterprises in the textile sector are. But it's not just the textile sector. It's simply one we focused on yesterday when they have no cash flow, no resilience at all. And of course, you can look to share buybacks and all sorts of things, but it's a terrible model when they can't survive 3 months. Imagine an organization like mine or others who didn't have reserves for 3 months. And so we're actually out there for the sake of workers, in my case, and our commitment to SMEs, despite the conditions in these countries, asking for the extension of SURE and other programs in Europe, we hope others in America, to allow them just to pay their contractual orders, because many are defaulting. It's an abominable picture of behaviour. While there are terrific other employers who are guaranteeing 90 days of employment, forward orders and so on, but I tell you, it's such a vulnerable economic model based on corporate greed. Let's call it what it is. It is the 1%, it is the demand, and we've allowed it to happen. So we have to go, I'm glad Pascal Lamy is not on my panel, even though I love him dearly, but we have to go back to a more balanced model, indeed, of production, and that means in trade. And we need bright brains to think about, because trade's part of our DNA. I'll never say trade's not in our interest. But when you look at what people, and we've already got a lack of trust in democracy, when you look at what people will demand for their own security, the optimism of jobs in a labour market that will now, not only is it 60% informal, but indeed now we'll have up to a loss of 200 million jobs. You're looking at those queues everywhere that America added another 4 million today. And also the capacity to scale up. They mightn't provide all the technical capacity or the production capacity, but a capacity to scale up in times of urgency, what we would call resilience. So all or nothing is the wrong frame. All or nothing is absolutely the wrong frame, because it will fail again, but also it's an injustice to the genuine concerns of people in all our countries. Just to give you one example of how we could actually look to a combined environment of competition and progress. Yesterday, I had a conversation with some of the health experts, and apparently we could buy whatever company produces it, we could buy for $10 billion the vaccine that would enable it to be available to everybody. $10 billion. We're spending about $10 trillion, and it might be $20 before this is over. For $35 billion, we could actually provide social protection floors for the 28 poorest of countries. For $100 billion, part payment for lower to middle income in a social protection global fund. Again, a drop in the ocean when you've got not only those 200 million losing their jobs, but up to 200 million now, 250 million facing starvation. It's that simple, because we've failed to regulate the labour market and put in place appropriate laws and social protections. And I would just say, because Pascal knows me well and I want to be provocative as always, but I want a genuine conversation on redefining protectionism. It's too easy. It's absolutely too easy. How do we rebalance? How do we get transparency? How do we end tax havens? All of those things. And I might add, the beauty of this is talking to the Nordic countries with their governments this morning, they're actually going to demand that company support comes with conditions, no tax havens, no share buybacks, absolute guarantee of wages for workers and so on. That's the kind of thoughtful regulation we need, not to stop global competition. Although I will say a favourite topic for Rana and I is ending the monopoly power of the big tech companies. And if you look at, I don't know why the other companies aren't screaming, because for an act of solidarity to give up civic freedoms and commercial activities to save lives, biggest in our history. Nevertheless, big physical companies have closed their doors, and Amazon's making a mozza, amongst others. And so, you know, with no absolutely terrible approach to workers and their rights and safety, but with no regulation at all. So are we going to have global monopolies? Is that the next big thing? And who reins them in? Because the current trade laws can't. Only governments can do that, and they're too big to do on their own. So again, part of that thoughtful conversation, what's the global future look like? So we would say to you, in building recovery and resilience through our economic models, our employment models, our sharing of global trade, we need to have a look at industry policy once again for climate and resilience as we transition every sector, but also for an integrated approach that says inequality has to be tackled, climate has to be tackled, and indeed we have to recover from COVID-19. A couple of other things like equality of women and economic participation on genuine terms, but allowing now, not constraining, allowing not just cost, not just the cost curve to go down, but real resilient development in developing economies. Thank you.
Okay, fantastic. Well, as usual, you've covered the waterfront. I'm particularly struck by your point about the big getting bigger, and it does seem that that's already happening. You can see it in the markets. You can see it in the cash flows of the largest companies. Let me ask you one follow-up question, Sharan, before we move on to Michael. Do you think that we can accomplish the rejiggering of the global trade system, you know, make some of the changes you're talking about within the framework of existing institutions, or do we need different institutions? I mean, how can the WTO do this? What does the new structure need to look like?
Well, I'm never one to throw out the baby with the bathwater, but I'm not convinced at the moment the WTO can deal in its current form and within the rigidity of its current rules with because they've been dominated by self-interest largely. I mean, I know Pascal can paint the other side and I might agree with some of it, but why have we had constrained development now for 40 years? Why have we not seen greater resilience in those poorer economies? Why is it that then we find ourselves, because of the cost down pressures, caught out where we have to look to innovation? I agree with Yossi, it's actually been a remarkable to watch. But I think we need to say, well, what else? What's there but what else? And where do we need real reform? And just even on the question of big tech alone, you cannot, you know, there is no one at the moment who can regulate on privacy, on surveillance regulation with a thoughtful approach, but it will take a whole lot of us. And therefore, I think the coming together of, you know, different voices. If you go back to the Havana Trade Agreement, this is a challenge to Pascal, really. I've been rereading the history of, because trade's existed throughout our entire, you know, human history. But if you go back to the Havana principles, they were much more human-centered. If you look at the institutional creation of Bretton Woods and indeed the ILO and the UN itself, after the Great Depression, two world wars, they were human-centered. But we've allowed corporations to fight and chip away out of self-interest and dominance at all of those, at the fundamental flaw of not just labor rights and social protection, but of humanity in many ways.
Okay, I'm going to give Michael his airtime in a minute, but Sharan, we've just got one question through from a listener for you. Your thoughts on how do we prevent Amazon from coming out the other side of this as the only one standing? Thoughts on
We have to have voices. I mean, people do not raise their voices now, which is why, despite helping the many of the M&Es in some sectors and working closely with a lot of business players, not all of them, we do a worst company of the week poll every week, but nevertheless, nobody except voices of civil society and a few great journalists are actually challenging them. So where's the corporate interest that has said for generations that, you know, antitrust measures, competition policy, even though I might have some reform measures I'd want to propose a part of the mix. I mean, I used to get sent to competition policy school for not reining in third-party boycotts and so on. Nobody at the moment looks to rein in what is in fact already global monopoly control. Market gangsterism in lots of ways.
Yeah, one other point we made, I'll just bookmark on the Amazon question for folks to think about. I think that this dovetails with geopolitics and with nationalism, and in particular with the conflict, long-term conflict between US and China, because you know, the tech companies have been trying to play both sides. Amazon has basically said, we think we're moving towards a bipolar world in which the US and China will have fundamentally different systems and technology. And so Amazon is essentially trying to ring fence defense, public procurement efforts in government. So a lot of complexity there and a lot of potential for sort of politicization in new ways. Maybe we'll talk about that too on our next panel. But let me come now, I hope Michael is on, to Michael Osterholm. Michael, if you weren't hearing me before, praise your 2005 piece in Foreign Affairs, where you basically laid out where we are today. and I'm just kind of amazed because you had a, here's what we should do short term, medium term, and long term kind of solution section. And none of it got done. So I'm curious why that is. Maybe you can kind of run us through what's happened in the 15 years or so since you wrote this article and why you think we're at the current moment. We'll start there. Michael, can you hear me?
I can. Thank you very much. I assume you can hear me now. I apologize for being late. There was a time mix up on the schedules here. Well, first of all, I wish we were back in 2005. Frankly, we were much better prepared back then for dealing with what we're dealing with now than we are now. In 2003, I was very involved with the SARS epidemic response and can tell you that we had very few concerns at the time that despite the fact that the problem was centered in Guangdong province of China, and that area of the world was hit hard by the SARS epidemic, we had very few international supply chains involving goods and needed services in the United States that were impacted by that SARS situation. Today, you obviously see a very different picture. Two things have happened, I think, that make for the challenge. One is where we now have our supply chains originate and how they move. And second of all, the elasticity of the supply chains, meaning that they basically aren't made for any kind of surge capacity. So the first thing I just want to clarify that one of the things I think that happens with supply chains is that there's so little transparency. We don't know in many cases all that make up the different component parts to a supply chain that ultimately have an impact on that final product. If you're making a mechanical ventilator that has 1,537 parts in it that come from 27 different countries, all it takes is one country, one part, to basically cause severe challenges to producing the rest of those mechanical ventilators. Another thing, it was mentioned by Christopher in his previous presentation, we have a lot of generalities about the supply chains, but for example, we've been the group that has been investigating the issue around drug shortages. It turns out that we've had real challenges here in the United States well before COVID-19 happened. And 18 months ago, we brought together a group of individuals, experts in all areas of medicine, and we identified 156 acute critical drugs, drugs you need right now or people die. What's on the crash cart, what's in the emergency room, what's in intensive care. And of those 156, all of them were generic, and about 90% of them were made outside the United States in one or more pieces. And I say one or more because you know, a drug is not just simply a drug. Sometimes the incipient and the active pharmaceutical ingredient is made in one country, shipped to another country, which is then shipped to a third country for final processing. And so it makes for a confusing situation. But the inability to track down these systems is remarkable. Our country's FDA has no really good system for that at all. The best country in the world is actually New Zealand, which we're working with very closely in this. Even then, there's not much transparency. And so before the Wuhan crisis happened, 63 of these 156 drugs were already in some shortage status, being all generic drugs. And since that time, we've been increasingly concerned. We hear numbers put out all the time about how much is what. And Christopher, your number of 90% is actually what people often use. We found that actually isn't even accurate, that the Chinese Indian contribution to antibiotics is very important. But ironically, one of the major manufacturing areas of the world for antibiotics happens to be the Lombardy region of Italy, where, again, active pharmaceutical ingredients are coming from China. As you may know, Lombardy was hit very hard with COVID-19 in Milan and made for even a greater challenge in terms of that. So one of the issues that we're dealing with right now on the drug shortage side is just trying to understand how to even track a supply chain to know how you can, in fact, anticipate shortages, what you can do about them. And the lack of transparency is huge. I can't tell you how many companies we deal with now around the particular COVID-19 situation where they're seeming very surprised to find out, oh my, we had no idea that in the end, the many different component parts came from that many different locations that all kind of came together. As one major automobile manufacturer said to us in discussing this, said, you know, we don't make anything, we just assemble things. And I think that that's a one challenge. The second challenge is elasticity. Let me just give you an example. Right now we're having a terrible problem globally with getting testing done for COVID-19. And people have said test, 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 and they are typically the people who have no clue about supply chains at all, including, I would even go so far as to say, Nobel Prize laureate economists who have insisted we could just do 40 million tests a week. Well, it turned out that the reagents or the chemicals, as well as the swabs that we need to do something as simple as this PCR testing, before Wuhan had a pretty steady state supply chain need. And so that basically was fed by a garden hose of reagent manufacturers, et cetera. When Wuhan happened and the Chinese situation greatly amplified the need for that, that system was basically able to expand itself to almost a fire hose kind of availability. But then when the whole world caught on fire with COVID-19, and now the whole world suddenly needs these reagents, we now need a canal full of them, not just a garden hose. And there is no elasticity there. And people have failed to realize that our own White House continues to keep talking about testing, 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 as if somehow it can defy the laws of physics. You know, basically, this is about how do you scale up a supply chain for manufacturing that doesn't exist? And how do you surge yourself? This is true for all across the board, everything we need right now, from personal protective equipment, mechanical ventilators, other medical supplies in general. The system was never made to absorb even a minor big bump, let alone a cataclysmic bump like we're seeing right now. So I think this has really redefined for many people what planning means. You know, when you put 35 million N95 respirators in a strategic national stockpile, and you have basically a need for likely close to 4 billion of those respirators during a period of a pandemic like this, the shortfall is so dramatic. It's not even really worth noting that you have a supply chain reserve anywhere at all because it goes so quickly. Just to give you some perspective on that, the leading manufacturer of N95s right now, the respirators we need, 3M, in the United States can produce about 35 million of these a month. In their work, their operations in China, about an equal amount that they then supply to the Asian markets. One hospital alone in the month of February in New York City use 2 million N95 respirators. Now, national production is 35 million a month, and one hospital alone used 2 million. It gives you an idea how ill-prepared we are to try to deal with an increasing supply chain need that suddenly has to be there. So as Secretary Rumsfeld once said, in paraphrasing him, you know, when you go to war, you don't get to go to war with what you want, you have to go with what you have. That same interview, he also, in understanding why the Humvees were not being readily and quickly fitted with appropriate armor, he said, it's not about the money, it's about physics. We just can't physically produce them fast enough, we don't have the capacity. So from my standpoint, what's happened is since 2005 is all of the elasticity, all of the reserve, all the potential for short-term gain in a supply chain has basically been lost. Hospitals don't stockpile anything, governments don't stockpile, and production can't even begin to start to deal with it. And the second thing I think that is important is when a crisis happens, where does it happen? These drugs that I just talked about, our own Defense Department is highly dependent on these same drugs, which they have no stockpile for. They too are highly dependent on China and India for these drugs. Imagine if we outsourced our munitions production and said, oh, by the way, we're gonna go to war with you in 6 months. Could you up the order for a couple of months, okay? In a sense, that's what we've more or less done right now. China owns us relative to many of these drugs, and the implications would be huge. Let me just leave you with one last thought. To understand that this is not a drug, but it's in the family of, almost a month ago, Our group made note that with all the cases of COVID-19 we were seeing, particularly in the New York metropolitan area, that we had to be worried about being able to dialyze these patients, because it turns out that many of the patients who are in intensive care or who survive that have such kidney damage they need to be dialyzed. We already have a population of individuals who need dialysis. Sure enough, even though we had predicted this, had made it known publicly, you needed to plan for it, 10 days ago, we started having a major crisis with dialysis in the greater metropolitan area of New York City because they ran out of dialysate, the chemical material that's used inside the dialysis machine. Could have easily been anticipated, at least for a few weeks moved around. Even that short-term warning didn't help us with a supply chain issue, let alone the overall production. So I would leave it there and just saying, right now, supply chains are the bane of my existence in terms of trying to prepare for or respond to a crisis like this. And what really surprises me is how many people who should be in the know about these supply chains don't have a clue. Okay. That is, I think, to me, a really important message.
Okay, I have about 100 more questions I'd like to ask you, but we've only got about 5 minutes left for this panel. Let me do two things. First of all, I want to just let everyone know that the OECD Secretary General, Angela Gurria, has just joined. So I want to just welcome, say a welcome, and if you'd like to come on the screen maybe himself or not. Anyway, I just want to let you all know that he's here and say welcome. And then I want to ask a question that's come through from Robert Kuttner, who's the co-editor of the American Prospect. I think this is a very interesting question. Given the abuses of monopoly capture of generics, shouldn't generics be made by either U.S. government or nonprofits on contract to U.S. government? Michael, do you want to grab that one? If others have thoughts, you can weigh in.
Well, first of all, we have to understand that the market forces brought to bear here are such that it's not a lucrative business to be in generics today. In fact, we are worried that we may lose 20-30% of the production capacity for the drugs I just mentioned over the next several years, as companies are saying, you know, we have opportunity costs doing this. There's other drugs we can do that are going to basically yield us a much greater profit. And so one of the things we have to look at is what are those strategic national products that we have to have? You know, no one suggests that there's an open market where you go on eBay and buy missiles or armaments that our governments through the military industrial era produces and buys. And what we haven't really understood and defined is what are the other strategic kinds of products that we need for everyday life to protect ourselves? And do we take on a whole new approach as opposed to a free market approach to these with a capitalist kind of an economy? These are ones that are that critical to us that we need to look at buying in a very different way so that we can induce people to want to be in this business and make a fair profit and also offer stability. The second thing is, when you're dealing with global issues like a pandemic, you have to be mindful that every place in the world is going to get hit. So it doesn't matter. But there are also challenges where if one country gets hit, if you have all of your production in that country, you have a real challenge. For example, just to follow up on Christopher's point again, where we do see a lot of the antimicrobial development and manufacturing in China also all happen to be concentrated in a region with the highest risk of earthquakes in all of China. Mm-hmm. You know, we've concentrated them all there. What were we thinking? Well, we weren't.
Okay. We've got about 2 minutes left. I want to bring, Yossi, I want to bring you back in. And since you didn't get as much airtime, do you want to respond to any of the points that have been raised? And also, just very quickly in a minute or so, if you could have one policy recommendation in terms of how we can start creating more resiliency now, what would it be?
Let me count the ways. Let me respond to a lot of stuff. But first, let me say that the medical supply chain is a special case, but the solution does not need to be local manufacturing. It is very hard to keep 3M to build the capacity to build billions of them billion of masks when the demand is 35 million a year. This is bad. What we can do in this particular case and in several other cases when we had critical elements is to store them. We used to have a critical element, it was called oil. We had the petroleum, the strategic petroleum reserve. So we can have, you know, 4 billion masks in a strategic reserve. And by the way, they should not be held in some cave in, you know, Omaha. They should be held by the distributors. We have a very, we have about 10 big distributors of medical supplies in the United States. To get a distributor license, you need to have certain inventory, large inventory, and people will order from this, so it will be a live inventory. There are lots of other things to think about because it's not enough to have, I was quoting, for example, it's not enough to have masks or ventilators. You need to have technicians. You need to have people. I was calling in some of my writing for a medical National Guard to have extra people who are, you know, volunteers and come once in a while. Finally, let me just say the comment about Amazon. There are many, many comments, but I'll try to to keep it short. The comment about Amazon, my estimate is it's the other way around. We have now thousands of companies, retailers, manufacturers who are getting good by necessity at online fulfillment. And I think Amazon will come out of it having a run for its money for a change. There are lots of people, local, just one quick example. We have a family business who used to supply restaurants in Everett, north of Boston. Now they're supplying households. And you get, we never ate such fresh food in our lives. Because now they, you know, every Friday you can order, you get the freshest food. The day before it was picked in the, you know, in the field, and you get it to you within a day. We are never gonna go back to Whole Food. Never, that's it, it's changed. I mean, so there are lots of these little things happening here and there. Companies are getting better. Actually, it's competing even with Amazon.
Okay, so, well, I'm sadly, because we are on a very tight clock here, I'm gonna have to stop you, but an optimistic place to stop, that's great. And Chris, I'm sorry you didn't get a second word, but everybody knows your details, so you can send questions in.